weather couldn't be better. We have a brilliant sun at this moment, and here comes the president now. In fact, he's not in his limousine. He's departed the limousine, and he is walking. He is reaching across the fence, shaking hands with many of the people who have come here to see him. He is closely accompanied by Dallas police officers and, of course, the Secret Service. He is now shaking hands, and they are walking along the line of the fence, shaking hands with some of the hundreds of people who have come here to view their arrival. And now, the President and First Lady are retreating from the fence. They're heading now for the official limousine where Governor Connally stands, waiting their arrival so that they can make their way downtown and out to the trademark. But this was one of those impromptu moments for which President Kennedy is so well known. So many times you have heard that the Secret Service men suddenly find themselves without the president, that suddenly he has left them and stepped into the crowd, the milling throng, and decided to shake hands and give his personal greetings. And this, once again, he did. There's the gunmetal gray limousine, blue and gray, pulling away now from the fenced area. The president and Mrs. Kennedy seated on the back seat. Governor and Mrs. Connally on the second seat.
So they are on their way to the parade route, which is in downtown Dallas. It snakes through Dallas. I'm going to show you just a little bit of the parade, and notice how close the people are and really what a dangerous situation it was. Turned out, obviously, the last time an American president rode in an open limousine.
The presidential limousine is turning right from Harwood Street onto Main Street and will head west for about 3/4 of a mile toward Dealey Plaza. On to Houston Street, heading for the corner of Elm Street, and the crowds are just beginning to thin out.
President's car is now turning onto Elm Street, and it will be only a matter of minutes before he arrives at the trademark. I was on Stemmons Freeway earlier, and even the freeway was jam-packed with spectators waiting their chance to see the president as he made his way toward the trademark.
Something has happened in the motorcade route. Something, I repeat, has happened in the motorcade route. Stand by.
This is the map of Dealey Plaza on the west end of Dallas. This shows the route, which is in red. Obviously, the shooting occurred just past the Texas School Book Depository building, which you see on the left. Ironically, the route had been planned to go straight instead of making that turn onto Houston Street. That would have forced the motorcade to go over the grass there at the bottom because they had to get to the right passage under the triple underpass. The president was going to the Dallas Trademark, which was a mile or so down the freeway. And they decided it wouldn't look good to have the cars going across the grass, so they changed the route to run it right by the School Book Depository building about 3 days before the assassination. This is really the last good picture right before the shooting started. Here's the first news reports, which I think are interesting because it was a day for journalism as well in the United States.
This is Walter Cronkite in our newsroom. There has been an attempt, as perhaps you know now, on the life of President Kennedy. He was wounded in an automobile driving from Dallas Airport into downtown Dallas, along with Governor Connally of Texas. They've been taken to Parkland Hospital there, where their condition is as yet unknown. We have not been told their condition. At Dallas, in the downtown hotel room, a group had been gathered to hear President Kennedy when he was waiting his arrival. Let's switch down there now, where Eddie Barker of KRLD is on the air. This is Walter Cronkite back at the CBS newsroom in New York. We have just been advised from Dallas that blood transfusions are being given to President Kennedy. Let us recall for you now what has transpired in this.
KRLD is reporting they've been told by somebody in the hospital, the president's dead. Only a rumor, but they've been told that KRLD is saying.
Well, that's a repeat of something that you heard reported to you directly a moment ago from KRLD television in Dallas, and that is the rumor that has reached them at the hotel that the president is dead. Totally unconfirmed, apparently, as yet. However, let's go back to KRLD in Dallas. It was just an hour ago that the incident took place. We have just learned, however, that Father Huber, one of the two priests called into the room, has administered the last sacrament of the church to President Kennedy. Regarding the probable assassin, the sheriff's officers have taken a young man into custody at the scene, a man 25 years old. We just have a report from our correspondent, Dan, rather in Dallas, that he has confirmed that President Kennedy is dead. There is still no official confirmation of this. However, it's a report from our correspondent, Dan Rather, in Dallas, Texas. From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago. Vice President Lyndon Johnson has left the hospital in Dallas, but we do not know to where he has proceeded. Presumably, he will be taking the oath of office shortly and become the 36th President of the United States.
Some scenes from the aftermath. This is on Air Force One. Now that's the School Book Depository building. The window that is marked an A on that picture is the so-called sniper's nest on the sixth floor of this warehouse for school books in Texas. That is the view from the sixth floor using, of course, wide-angle lenses from that era. If you've ever been to the site, it's much more compact and small. If you've looked out that window, which you can do today, there's a museum on the floor. There were reports initially that a policeman was shot, Officer J.D. Tippett, and then the arrest at the Texas Theater in the Oak Cliff neighborhood of Dallas. We'll talk about Oswald in a moment. Here this is a different era. Oswald was held at the Dallas City Jail, which was a crowded place. Reporters could walk up to his jail cell and ask him questions, and others could as well because there was no security in the place. And actually, when they took him for interrogations out of the cell, he was paraded by the news media on the way back, where he was asked questions, and here's a little snippet.
Has admitted nothing.
I really don't know what the situation is about. Nobody has told me anything except that I'm accused of murdering a policeman. I know nothing more than that, and I do request for someone to come forward to give me a legal assistance.
Did you kill the president?
No, I've not been charged with that. In fact, nobody has said that to me yet. The first thing I heard about was when the newspaper reporters in the hall asked me that question.
You have been.
Nobody said what?
Sir?
You have been.
Nobody said what?
Okay.
Give me a hand here.
Okay.
What did you do in Russia?
A policeman hit me.
Oswald's Russian.
And then after 44 hours in Dallas police custody, they decided maybe we should move him to the more secure county jail. So Sunday morning, as millions were watching on television, actually worldwide because this was broadcast live, he was being transferred to the jail.
Saw the shot fired, said it was fired by a man wearing a black hat, a brown coat, a man that everyone down here thought was a Secret Service agent. Oswald was moved immediately from the area. No one knows at this time where Lee Harold Oswald is. At the present time, word is that an ambulance is being ready to take Oswald away. We can hear sirens outside, and an ambulance apparently is moving down now into the basement. Here comes the ambulance. And Oswald will be removed now. The ambulance is being pulled up in front of us here.
It is almost unbelievable.
Here, someone has...
Get back!
Back. Okay, just get low. Okay. Pat, can you move?
Okay. Pat, move just a little to your left.
We can see now that police are hemming off the newsmen in the basement of Dallas City Hall, hemming them off so that Lee Oswald can be taken to an ambulance, which was just brought into the basement of the City Hall. We're switching now to Bob Huffacker downstairs.
Oswald will be moved quickly outside. And the only word so far is that the shot came from a man wearing a black hat and a coat. Here comes Oswald. He is ashen and unconscious at this time, now being moved in. He's not moving. He's in the ambulance now, and attendants, police are quickly climbing in. They're now having to remove the armored truck from the head of the basement entrance here.
For the situation at this hour in Washington, let us go now to the White House and Robert Pierpoint.
Oswald was shot in the abdomen by a Dallas businessman named Jack Ruby. There's the famous Associated Press photograph. He died within 45 minutes in the same trauma room as President Kennedy had died 2 days earlier. Oswald was handcuffed on both sides, and obviously it was difficult for him to resist the shot. Ruby arrived at just the right time with his gun. And then the aftermath. Now, I could talk a lot about what happened right after. I want to get into the evidentiary matters. As you all know, the President of the United States, new President Lyndon Johnson, appointed a Blue Ribbon Commission to investigate. It has become known over history by the name of its chair, Chief Justice Earl Warren, as the Warren Commission. It was not a special investigating body. It was a group of what the President considered to be wise men, balanced with experience and Republican and Democratic sides of the aisle, with entrusted to decide what should be made public at the end of this investigation. Their key decision was that Oswald had acted alone from the shooting from the sixth floor in the building where he was employed. The so-called magic bullet theory, which I'm going to explain in a minute. If you recognize a young guy on the left, it's Arlen Specter, who went on to become a senator from Pennsylvania for many years. He was one of the lawyers in the Warren Commission. And the so-called single bullet theory was his. This I'm going to run through fast because we don't have too much time. It just talks about how the records were sealed relatively quickly. And if you watched the movie JFK, you learned all about the New Orleans sideshow, the prosecution of Clay Shaw, the only person actually ever prosecuted for the murder of President Kennedy. He was acquitted quickly, but his life was ruined as a result. So that Zapruder film that we saw briefly and we're going to look at in more detail was actually never shown publicly until 1975, except for a few bootleg copies that had made their way out. And that caused a lot of consternation, given people thought it couldn't have come from, the shot couldn't have come from the back. We had a second investigation, the House Select Committee on Assassinations, in the late Senate in the 1970s, a massive investigation, closed up relatively early. Their conclusion was that there were two shooters that day, not one, that Oswald had been shooting from the sixth floor, and his shots had hit the president, that there had been a shooter on the grassy knoll behind where Zapruder was standing, and that a person had missed in his shots. The key to this was recorded sounds that were picked up on a tape recorder in the Dallas police station. Two of the motorcycles in the parade had inadvertently left their microphones on, so they recorded the sounds of the shooting. And the problem has been through the years in synchronizing the two tape recordings, because one of the tape recorders was skipping. And therefore, they've had a hard time ever synchronizing. Some people hear six, seven, perhaps even eight shots. Other people hear only three. And so that has caused that controversy over the years. So they did determine that there was a conspiracy, but they were unable to determine more. There's the movie which created a statute that that resulted in our appointments. This is the board that I chaired before we when we were sworn in by Justice Ginsburg, who's in the middle. This is kind of the legal stuff of our work and what we found. That's obviously how we declassified a lot of the information that was still secret. Oswald, everyone talks about Oswald and whether he could have done this sort of thing. Let's take a minute and talk about Oswald before we get to the other evidence. Oswald was a kid who had grown up without a father and a mother who moved. He attended at least 15 different schools during his school years. His mother had some mental health issues. Oswald himself was the kind of person which all of you probably remember, who was probably clever enough to take apart a car engine and put it back together again, but couldn't ever get anything better than a D- in a class in school. Just an inability to focus and concentrate. He left his mother and joined the Marine Corps, where he was stationed in Japan, actually near the area where the U-2 flights were done, were taking off for their flights over the Soviet Union. He was not particularly popular in the Marines because he started espousing Marxist theology. And if you're a member of the Marine Corps, being a Marxist is not a particularly popular idea. His shooting record was mixed, some good, some bad. He eventually was discharged, and he went to the Soviet Union. Told his mother he was going to go study in Europe, in Switzerland, and he took off, and he finally crossed into the Soviet Union at the Finnish border, one of the Finnish border crossings, and he announced that he wanted asylum, that he was a Marxist, and he was ready to embrace Soviet ideology. The Soviets, after a brief investigation, didn't agree. It told him to get lost. He was being deported back out of the country. He allegedly tried to kill himself. They decided this didn't look good, so they sent him to Minsk, far enough away from Moscow to keep him away from trouble, they thought. He had a job, and they watched every single thing that he did. There are files today in Minsk with a copy at the Kremlin, which stand about that high. Just folder on top of folder, virtually everything that Oswald did over the course of his 2+ years in the Soviet Union. He eventually returned to the United States. People ask, why did the State Department let him in after what he had done in Russia? Well, the short answer is that during that era of Cold War propaganda, if you had defected to the Soviet Union and you wanted to come back home, you were let back in instantly because that was considered a propaganda victory. He was in New Orleans for a while where he was arrested. That caused the connections that led to the later Garrison prosecution. Returned to Texas. He bought a rifle through the mail at Chicago Sporting Goods store. A Carcano rifle, which is an Italian-made, basically an infantry rifle for soldiers. I paid $12.40 or so for the gun, which came with a 4-power scope. He was being investigated by the FBI for shooting shots through the window of a virulent anti-communist general who was retired living in Dallas. He had left his wife at the time. He'd made a strange trip to Mexico City in the fall of 1963, visiting the Cuban and Soviet embassy. We know exactly what he did because both the FBI and the CIA had the Cuban and Soviet embassies bugged, every room. Of course, not the same bug, they had to do it separately because they didn't cooperate with each other at the time. So we knew that he was up to something. And that fact was never, unfortunately, communicated to the Secret Service, despite the fact that he was working in a building right along the parade route. He came to work that day carrying a big package. He said it was curtain rods for his new apartment. Actually, he was living in a rooming house that didn't require curtains. He was alone in that part of the building during the assassination. He left the building quickly thereafter. The police, who had already zeroed in on the building, stopped him. The supervisor said, oh, he's okay, he works here. They let him go. And the rifle, of course, was found up on the 6th floor in the back of the room. There were 3 spent shells found by the window. He had fixed boxes in the background and had everything all set up to make it a sniper's nest. His palm prints and fingerprints were all over the rifle. He went home, he changed, he grabbed a gun, took off. Where he was going, no one really knows, but a cop who was hearing broadcasts of individuals who were in the book depository building at the time stopped him because he thought he looked like this guy. He walks up to him and Oswald walked straight towards him and shot him, killing him. And you saw his picture earlier. He went into a shoe store acting strange. They called the police. He was eventually arrested in the Texas theater. And there's his booking photo at the right. Actually, it was not a federal crime to kill the President of the United States in 1963. It was simply a state law murder case. And therefore, the FBI and any federal agency had no jurisdiction. The FBI tried to get into the interrogation sessions saying they had jurisdiction because it was a federal crime to assault a federal officer. And the Dallas police laughed at the FBI agent and told him to get lost. This caused all kinds of problems. Obviously, that problem has been fixed if this should ever happen again today. And there's another picture of the shooting. He was only alive for 44 hours in custody. There's a little bit more about the files that still exist in the KGB files, which are a very interesting part of all of this. Something the Warren Commission was not aware of, Operation Mongoose, which was our pretty detailed attempt over a number of years to kill Fidel Castro. Obviously, we weren't very successful since he's still alive, and no one from our side of the table from that era is still alive today. We did a lot of looking into the medical records aspect of all of this. It's a very difficult and confusing part. Those are the three autopsy physicians. The autopsy should have been, by law, carried out in Dallas by the Dallas County Coroner. It was not. The Secret Service, aware of the jurisdictional problem, literally raced to the airport to get away from the coroner, who had a court order keeping the body there, and got out of Dallas fast enough before they could be arrested and the body kept there. A lot of issues relative to the medical evidence. A lot of the photographs are missing. The notes were burned. There were substantial interferences in the autopsy room. I want to look at the movie now for a second. The circle there is circles Abraham Zapruder. He was a Dallas business guy. He was a dressmaker, actually. I don't know that he designed dresses for women, but he made them in his little shop. And he had a new movie camera that day. He left it at home because it was cloudy. If you remember the 1960s, you didn't take pictures outside unless it was sunny for some reason. And that was his thinking, that he wouldn't get a good movie shot. But in fact, his assistant said, go home and get the movie camera. It's new. It's a nice piece of equipment. You're never going to see a president in a parade again. And so he went to get it, and he stood on a pedestal there. You can see the grassy knoll behind him, grassy knoll being sort of a perfect place for an assassin. But he filmed the assassination. It became the most important piece of evidence and one of the most awful crimes in our country's history, a public assassination of a president. And it changed the way everyone looked at the case. There is Abraham with his camera. At the end of our work, unable to convince the family to donate the film to the American people, we took it, and they were paid handsomely for it, unfortunately. But let's look at the film, and then I'm going to go into some detail with you on the film. So this is before, and you see the president waves. He goes behind the Stemmons Freeway sign, and he's hit sometime right after that, okay? Now, let me talk about the frames while we're in the middle of this. The Zapruder film runs at a little over 18 frames per second. Okay? The fastest that the FBI's best marksman could fire accurately, the Carcano rifle, the same rifle, was about 2.3 seconds. This is a bolt-action rifle. It's nothing automatic about it at all. Those of you who are hunters know that a bolt-action, after you fire, you have to pull up the bolt, pull it back, that expels the shell, and then you push a new bullet into the chamber, pull the bolt down, then you aim and shoot again. 2.3 seconds, which is pretty quick, is as fast as the best FBI marksman could shoot the rifle accurately. So 2.3 seconds is 42 Zapruder frames. So keep that in mind, 42 frames. Now the timing of the shots. We just saw, I'm going to go back to the beginning of this, right here. Now this is where it begins. I mean, there's earlier shots, but this is where the limousine comes around the corner, and the film is zoomed in a little bit here, even though it is still a little foggy. But this is where it begins. The conventional wisdom is that there was a first shot that missed everything. The conventional wisdom is that shot came at between frames 155 and 157. You see we're sitting at 133 right now. Perhaps Oswald was trigger happy. The the limousine had to come out behind a tree before the target was visible. The first shot missed everything, hit the sidewalk, injuring a man named James Teague, who was hit by flying concrete on his face, which he had to go to the hospital for. There's some new theories that are floating around this early first shot, but I won't get into those. Now, the president goes behind the Stemmons Freeway sign at around frame 205. So you see that happening here, and then it'll stop. So he's still waving as they go. There's frame 205. So the earliest that he could have been hit was frame 205. That's the moment he goes behind the sign. And he's reacting at 221, 222 when he emerges, so he's been shot at that point in time. We know that for sure. His arms are moving up like this. It's a neurological reaction to being hit near the spinal cord on the back, upper back, which is where he was shot. So the question becomes, was Connolly shot by a different bullet? If he was, the timing is such that the Oswald rifle could not have done it. Here's the theory, Arlen Specter's theory that the Warren Commission bought, that one bullet caused all the damage to Kennedy and Connolly. Kennedy hit in the back, bullet comes out the throat. There was a throat wound obliterated by a tracheotomy at the hospital, so we can't tell from pictures whether it was an entrance or an exit wound, but the theory is that that's an exit wound. Governor Connolly, who is seated on the jump seat, not at the side of the car, but toward the middle of the limousine, he's hit in the upper right back, and then the bullet goes through, actually comes out right at his nipple, and goes through his upper left thigh, and then his wrist, and then falls out in the car, where it emerges pristine, which is the so-called magic bullet, doing all this damage and emerging pristine. Now you can tell for yourself here about the frames. So let's look at the frames again. 42 frames, fastest that gun could be fired. So if he was hit, the president was hit immediately at frame 205 when he went behind that sign, then about the fastest that gun could have been fired would be a shot with Connolly being hit at frame 247. So if we look at Zapruder again, here's where the limo clears the sign. President's arms are moving up. So you tell for yourself what's going on. Connolly first exhibits a slight grimace and arching of the back at frame 223 or 224. You'll see this in a moment. And then between frame 228 and 230, the white hat, his Stetson or whatever you call it, jerks up and down, and his full reaction, which looks like a scream in agony, comes somewhere between 232 and 240. At frame 224, there's a lapel flip, a flip of his lapel of his suit. No one's quite sure whether that's a bullet going through, a reaction to a bullet, or was it the wind. Let's look at that right now. Remember the, watch Connolly. See, he's turning, there's a hat, and then the, look at the scream right there. Remember frame 247 would have been the fastest they could have shot a second shot from the sixth floor. And we're still at 240. So depending on when the first shot hit, Connolly is reacting to being shot a minimum of 10 frames after that first one and an absolute maximum of 40. And that maximum assumes that JFK is shot the moment he disappears behind the sign. But you know, both of those are well short of the 42 frames necessary to reload and fire a second time, even by the best marksman in the FBI. This is the analysis that led the Warren Commission to conclude that a single bullet had hit both Kennedy and Connolly. Two bullets, in all likelihood, could not have come fast enough from Oswald's rifle. So if Connolly was hit by a separate bullet, which he believed he was, and his wife, sitting next to him, believed he was hit by a separate bullet. Then it could not have come from the sixth floor. It would have had to have come from a different rifle. The fatal headshot, which you'll see in a moment, is at frame 313. That's between 88 and 108 frames after the magic bullet, or somewhere between 4.8 and 5.9 seconds, which is plenty of time for an accurate shot from the sixth floor. The limousine is on a plane going downhill, so the rifle could be kept at almost a steady level. The headshot hit at about 275 feet from the sniper to the target. Remember, he has a four-power scope on that rifle. Unfortunately, the driver of the limousine, Secret Service agent, instead of when he heard commotion in the back seat, stepping on the accelerator, he slowed down and turned around to see what was going on, making the car moving very slowly at the time of the fatal headshot. And you can see that. We'll look at the rest of the film here now. This is Kennedy reacts. Conley's looking back at him, and the limousine is slowing there. Hard to tell, but that's the headshot, which we brought in experts to look at all the remaining autopsy materials. That's Clint Hill, the Secret Service agent, the only one who figured out what was going on, rushing to get on the limousine. Clint is still living today, had a lifetime of being greatly regretful about what happened, wishing he could have taken the bullet. A lot of alcoholism problems. He's kind of recovered from that. He's written a few books that are very interesting. He's actually a North Dakota farm boy who went to Concordia College in Moorhead and was a football player there and recruited into military intelligence and then the Secret Service. A very interesting life. But the headshot, you know, we brought in experts to come in and look at all the stuff we had gathered, the photographs, the x-rays, all the autopsy materials, some of the best pathologists in the country, and asked them, what do you see? And I don't know a lot of this talk. I'm not a medical expert. I just sat in the back of the room and watched them. They worked for almost a full day. And their conclusion was they found no evidence of any shot coming from anywhere but the back. The back shot, now digitalized on a computer from the faded 1960s photographs that we found, showed the back wound to be clearly an entrance wound in their view. Obviously, they couldn't tell about the throat wound because it was obliterated in the tracheotomy. But the head shot, they called a trenching wound, which meant that it just barely hit the top of the back of the president's head and trenched along as it disintegrated, and that bullet disintegrated into many pieces. And then it obviously cracked his skull. You see that flap of skull that opens up when it's hit. But they said quite possibly the bullet itself never touched brain tissue. It just barely hit him at the top of the head, trenched along, but that the pressure caused by the bullet coming through would have destroyed a considerable amount of brain tissue. And for all practical purposes, President Kennedy was dead immediately, although he was kept alive for probably 20, 25 minutes after the assassination. Jack Ruby. He was a nightclub owner in Dallas, owned a couple of nightclubs. One was a strip club. The cops liked him because they could always go over to Jack's club and get whatever favors cops get at a club like that. He had associations with organized crime. He had grown up in Chicago and known Sam Giancana, who was a Chicago mob boss. He did some small-time things for organized crime, nothing big. His world was Chicago, Las Vegas, and Dallas, and to a lesser extent, Havana, where organized crime reigned supreme until Castro took over. You know, his motivations are unclear. He said once that he did it because he wanted to prevent Jackie Kennedy from having to come back to Dallas to testify at a trial, which would have been unlikely. The other thing he said, he was a patriotic American. He was striking back for all Americans. He did arrive at the police station at just the right moment as he walked down the ramp. Of course, the police knew him. He'd been in the Dallas police station for much of the weekend. The camera pans around the room. He's standing at the back of the room. So there's some evidence he stalked Oswald throughout the whole weekend. When he was arrested and charged with capital murder, he was apparently surprised. He had had a friend call an agent to talk about a movie deal. He thought that he might get a light slap on the back of the hand, and then he could pursue a life of riches afterwards. He was convicted and sentenced to death. That conviction was overturned by the Texas Court of Criminal Appeals because they said that his trial should have been moved to some other place in Texas. Well, I mean, I was a 10-year-old kid in northern Minnesota watching him shoot Oswald on the morning of November 24th. Much of the world was watching and had seen that movie. I'm not sure he would have gotten a different trial in El Paso than he got in Dallas, but he had lung cancer by that time, and he was never retried. He died awaiting retrial, so he was never officially convicted of the murder of Oswald. There's conflicting evidence that at times he said he had a bigger story to tell, but he wouldn't tell it in Texas because he would not live to see the end of the day. He wanted to be taken to Washington, and no one would agree to move him to Washington, thinking that he was probably just bluffing. In any event, the death of Oswald robbed everyone of a lot of potential information about what really had gone on. There are a lot of different conspiracy theories that people have come up with. If you've read any of the books, they are described in a lot of the books. About the only one that I think has some relevance today and is still part of a lot of research going on, and that is that organized crime may have played a role. There's precious little direct evidence of that. In fact, Ruby is probably the most direct evidence of an organized crime involvement, shutting up Oswald quickly. There are some people who said that they saw Oswald and Ruby together in the days before the assassination. That was never proven. Oswald was dead, Ruby wasn't talking, and the witnesses, largely employees of Ruby, were somewhat discredited. So we don't know really very much other than organized crime certainly had a motivation to kill President Kennedy at the time. Organized crime figures, several of them have claimed credit for it, particularly as they have been dying. The Tampa mob boss told his lawyer that we killed the wrong Kennedy, we should have killed Bobby instead of Jack. There's precious little evidence. The direct evidence all points to Oswald. The gun was his prints all over it. He had the opportunity and he had probably motivations because he had these notions that he should be a famous person, these notions of grandeur. So a lot of other things I could discuss. I don't want to go too long.